Willy. I'm the political editor at Kompas Newspaper in Jakarta, and I'll be moderating today's discussion. This discussion is part of the International Conference on Political Party Finance Reform Agenda in Southeast Asia that is initiated by the Association of Elections and Democracy, or Perludem Indonesia, together with Bersih 2.0 Malaysia and Legal Network for Truthful Election Lente in the Philippines, and Pradet and Women Caucus Timor-Leste, and also with the support of the USAID through the Asia Pacific Regional Support Program for Elections and Political Transition, or RESPECT Program. But before we start, I would like to inform you that this webinar is connected in two languages. So if you see on the bottom right of the screen, under the interpretation function, you can choose that and you can select Indonesian language, so you can follow the discussion in Bahasa Indonesia. Political party finance is still a serious problem for many countries in Southeast Asia, including Indonesia. There have been lots of discussions about the negative impact of the lenient regulations and law enforcement regarding political party finance, as well as election campaign finance, the dependency of political parties toward third parties, the donor, and also the issues of clientelism and corruptions, vote buying in elections, and high political costs in the election have become part of the political party financial problem in Indonesia. Activists, civil society organizations, political scientists have suggested the implementation of more transparent and accountable political party finance report, followed by adequate financial support from the government, as a way to overcome the problem. KPK, the Indonesian Education Commission, in 2019, suggested that the government should increase funding to 10,000 Indonesian rupiah from 1,000 Indonesian rupiah per vote that political parties get from an election. However, this should not be done with several requirements. For example, more transparency in the political party finance report, international democratizations within the political parties. However, so far, so little has been changed. And even there are several cases where money from corruption cases out to political parties' activities or for a candidate activities in an election. All of those phenomena have made political parties seen negatively by the public, which lead to low public trust toward political parties. And this is not healthy for democracy, since political parties play a critical role as the producer of the leaders in political offices. We have today with us four distinguished speakers that will scrutinize this topic from four different perspectives. Please welcome Heroik Pratama from Perludem, and then Mbak Titi Anggraini from Perludem, Bang Fritz Edward Ciregar from Election Oversight Body, and also Mbak Lena Mariana Mukti from Partai Persatuan Pembangunan. We'll have more or less 2 hours to discuss this topic and try to find some solutions out of the problem that we'll be discussing. And each speaker has around 15 minutes to share their thoughts, and then we will have around 20 minutes for question and answer session. And that will leave us around 10 minutes for each of the speakers to sum up their idea. If you already have questions during the speaker's presentation, you can also use the Q&A function under the screen, and then you can type your question there. And then when we enter the Q&A sessions, then I will ask you to deliver your question directly, if you choose to do so, I can also read the question for you. But before we start our discussion, we firstly will hear an opening remarks from the Executive Director of Perludem, Khoirunnisa Nur Agusiati, or we usually call her Baninis. Baninis, the screen is yours.
Okay, thank you, Mas Anthony Lee. Good day, everyone. Thank you for joining us in this virtual conference of Political Party Finance Reform Agenda in Southeast Asia. And today's conference is about Political Party Finance Reform Agenda in Indonesia. This conference is part of International Democracy Day commemoration that we celebrate every year at 15 September. This is a series of international conference on Political Party Finance Reform Agenda in Southeast Asia that's supported by USAID under the RESPECT program, or Asia Pacific Regional Support for Elections and Political Transitions program. This is the third session of international conference. The first is held on September 13, and the second is about political party finance reform in the Philippines that held on September 14. If you guys missed these last two conferences, you can check on our Perludem's YouTube channel. And the next conference will be held by our partner from Malaysia, Bersih 2.0 and Timor Leste, by Pradet and Women Caucus. Heroi, can you show the cover of the book? So, ladies and gentlemen, if we talk about the political party finance in Southeast Asia, especially in Indonesia, there is still lack of comprehensive regulation, not only for the limitation of donation or spending, but also about the reporting and audit process of political finance. We already finished our research about political party finance, and as you can see on the screen, this research can be downloaded in our website. I will share you the link of the website on the chat box. To disseminate research as well as to discuss the agenda of political party finance reform in Southeast Asia, we held a series of international conferences. This is also collaboration with the International IDEA, Lente from the Philippines, Bersih 2.0 from Malaysia, and Pradet and Women Caucus from Timor Leste. And last, I would like to send my gratitude to all writers and also speakers for this conference, Bapak Fritz Edward Siregar, member of Election Oversight Body, Ibu Lena Mariana Mukti, our female politician from P3, PPP, and soon to be our ambassador for the state of Kuwait, Mbak Titi Anggraini, member of Perludem's Advisory Board, and Heroik Pratama, Perludem's researchers. Thank you everyone for making the time for this conference. Have a great discussion. Back to you, Mas Anthony.
Thank you, Mbak Denise. Now we will start our discussion. I will introduce our first speaker, Heroik M. Pratama. He is a political researcher at the Association of Election and Democracy of Perludem in Indonesia. He has a strong interest in issues relating to election and political parties and democracy. In 2019, Heroik was an international observer for Thailand's election with the Asian Network for Free Elections, or ANFREL. Heroik has written several publications on electoral issues, and his latest publication is Adoption of Voting Technology, a Guide for Electoral Stakeholders in Indonesia, that was published by Perludem and also International IDEA. Heroik will be talking about political party finances in Indonesia, a never-ending reform, which is based on his research on this topic. Mas Oi, the screen is yours. You have 15 minutes to share your thoughts. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mas Anthony. Good day, everyone. First of all, also I would like to say thank you to the all panelists. Pak Fritz, the member of Election Supervisory Body, thank you for your time. Bulena, and also our mentor, Mbak Titi Anggraini, thanks for your time. I would like to present the chapter 2 of Political Party Finance Reform in Southeast Asia book that has focused on Indonesia issue. This chapter has written by Perludem. Written by Pluto. Maybe I will share my screen first. Actually, when we talk about the political party finance issues in Indonesia, there are a lot of publications related to the political party finance. As we know, there are some fundamental publications in Indonesia about political party finance issues, like from Edward Aspinall, Ward Benesort, and other scholars, and also from our colleges in civil society organizations, such as from Indonesian Corruption Watch, and LIPI, and also Pusako. They also write the issues about the political party finance issue. But our focus on this research is trying to reviewing legal framework of political party finance in Indonesia and try to make some policy recommendations to the DPR and also to the government to reform the political party finance issues in Indonesia. As we know, there was a daily routine agenda every 5 years to revise the election laws and also political parties law. Unfortunately, every bill every bill cannot solve the fundamental problems about political party finance issues in Indonesia, like mentioned by the moderators, such as the transparency and accountability, the relations between the political party finance and also the corruption politics, and also the highest cost politics for candidate and political party who run in elections. Maybe we still remind back where in several years ago, there is an issue to change the mechanism of elections in local head because the high cost of politics that spent by the candidate in local head elections. And the reason is the main background of this is because the high cost politics. According our research, actually it is not about the mechanism of the elections of the local head. It is about the regulations of the political party finance. That's why in this chapter two, the publications, we try to make some elaborations about the political party finance issues, especially in a legal review in Indonesia. Before I start with the recommendations, I would like to make some brief explanations first regarding about the political party finance and campaign finance context. As we know, there are some agreement between the scholars. When we talk about political party finance, there are two types of political party finance. First, political party finance related with the outside of elections. I mean like the spend of money, the use of money from political party to run their organizations outside the elections periods. And the second type is the campaign finance. This campaign finance is the use and the rule of money inside the elections period, especially for the candidate and political party for running their campaign. In Indonesia, these two types of the political party finance issues despite in two different law. First, the elections laws, that regulations about the rule of money in election that's spent by a political party and also the candidates. And the second is the political party laws, that the use of the rule of money that used in outside the elections. But one of the interesting of those two types of regulations is about the scope of issues. There are similarities between the scope of issue that regulated in election law and also political party laws. For example, the source of donations. The source of donation that regulating in the elections law and also the political party laws, it's similar. The source of donations come from the candidate, from the political parties and the member of political parties, and also from the third funding. The third funding is from the individual and also from the private corporate to donate to the political parties and also from the groups. And the second, the similarities between this scope of issues in from to laws is about the donations limitation for individual and also for private corporate, even though the numbers of the limitation is different every elections laws and also from the political parties laws. And the second is the similarities that regulating the election laws and political party laws is the mechanism of report and also the audit mechanism. Even though for elections law, the report submitted by the political parties and the candidate to the Indonesia Election Commissions, then will be audited by the private audit. But from in the political party laws, the report submitted to the state auditors. And the state auditors will be audit the political party's finance report related with the public fund that political party receives in every years. And the last one of the similarity of elections law and political party laws is about the prohibitions and the sanctions. Every elections law and also political party laws not allow every political parties and candidate to receive the donations from the foreigners and also to receive the donations from the illegal source, and also to receive the donation from the state government. But even though there is some in-kind subsidy in elections and also in political parties law for public funding that source from the state to the political party. And the other things there is one difference. Even though we have different elections law, but just only the adoptions of expenditure limitations for local head elections just only regulated in local head elections law. But in legislative law and also in presidential law, there is no implementations of expenditure limitations. It just only implement in local head elections. This is one of our focus study. We try to elaborate why the expenditure limitation just only implement in local head elections, not in legislative elections, not in presidential elections. And if we see, this is the captures of the comparisons of the percentage of donations to the political parties and to the candidates from the 20 and 14 elections and 20 and 19 elections. There are the relations between the electoral system that we use, the open list of proportional representations, with the sorts of donations. Because the nature of the open list proportional representation based on the candidate-centric competitions, so the candidate, the donations, the money for political parties and candidate to run the elections, it also come from the candidate. More than 80% the source of donations in DPR elections in 20 and 14 election and also 20 and 19 elections, it's come from the candidate. But from the other source of donation, from the third funding donation, such as private corporate, group, and also individual, is very low percentage. And also the low percentage donations to the political party itself, it also low. If we see just only 11% and also 13% in 20 and 19 elections, political party as institutions donate to run their campaign. On our study, conclude that this is the impact of the open list proportional representation because the competition based on the candidate. So the candidate itself responsible to fund their campaign. And the second, one of the interesting of our finding in this research is about the serial number of candidates. If we see the nature of open list proportional representations, the variable of a serial number of candidates, it's not impactful to the elected. But if we compare from the 2009 elections until 20 and 19 elections, the candidate of the legislative candidate who received the number one of the list, who always elected. And it also, if we see the total candidate campaign fund from the candidate, from the whole candidate in 16 political parties who run in 20 and 19 elections, it's very high also. So that's why I think there is the really the relations between the serial number of candidate that candidate received in the list of candidate with the total number of campaign fine. When the candidate have received the number one candidate, it also impactful to the total total candidate campaign fund that candidate doing in campaign. Even though the electability of candidate based on the serial number is in fact inseparable from the amount of the campaign fund spent. Based on report on the receipt of campaign funds and expenditure for campaign funds, candidate for legislative member who receive serial number one spend fairly large amount of campaign funds compared to other serial number. There is no positive correlations between the greater and the serial number obtained by the candidate, the less the amount campaign funds spent. However, referring to the campaign finance report data, most of those who receive serial number one and two spend much larger campaign fund compared to the other the serial number. And the other thing, if we see the comparisons between the elections law and in legislative law and also in the local head elections law, the revisions of this law always impact with the increasing the donation limitation campaign fines. If we see in 2004 elections, the donation limitation for the individual is 100 billion. But in 2009, it's very increasing, increasing again, and always increasing until 2019 elections. The question is, where is this number come from? I mean, like, when the legislative and also the policymaker try to increasing the donation limitations, is there any formula they use to calculate or to formulate the donation limitations, or they just increasing without any formula? It is the reason why I think when we talk about the high cost politic, we should discuss about the formulations and the formulation how to make donation cap in campaign finance, because every elections law and every political party laws in Indonesia, we don't know the background of the policymaker when they increase the donation limitations. Based on that, we try to make some comparative studies. We collect the data from the other country based on the international IDEA database. Actually, there are three types formula for calculating the limit for campaign funds in fund donations in every country. First is fixed amount. It's similar with Indonesia. We don't know the background why the policymaker use increasing the donation limitations. In Italy also, in France also, there are fixed amount in that regulated in the elections law without any formula or any calculations to calculate the donation limitations. It is the model ones. And the second models is based on the applicable minimum wage. So in Portugal, third party such as individual and business can donate campaign fund of at least 60 times of the salary that they receive by the donor. So the maximum limit for campaign fund donations, and also in Paraguay, it's equivalent with 10,000 days of minimum salary earned by the donor. So so the cap of donation limitations is based on the wage that they receive every month. And the result of donation limitation has difference of each region. I mean, because if we contextualize in Indonesia, we have a different minimum wage in every regions, every city, and also every regency. So when we adopt this model, every regions, every electoral district will be have a different donations limitation based on the minimum wage that adopt in every regions. And the third type of donation limitation based on previous elections campaign fund expenditure. So if the political party participant in previous elections spend, for example, 1 billion, so the other political party who run the elections not allowed to receive donations more than 1 billion that political party receive political party expend in previous elections. This model adopt in South Korea. For example, the limitations on campaign fund donation from third party is equivalent to 10% of the campaign fund spent by election participant in previous elections. It's also adopted in Mexico, which impose a maximum limit in campaign fund donation of 10% the total limit on campaign fund expenditure in previous elections. Refer to the last campaign fund expenditure or the limit of on campaign fund expenditure, one of the drawbacks or the limitations of this model is that the donations and campaign limit is determined by the other political participant in previous election. So it is not actually contextual for political parties and candidate. Based on the three types, this our research come from with purpose for the formulations to the second type of based on the applicable minimum wage, because we think this is more relevant for Indonesia context, and also every regions and every province have different minimum wage, and I think it's relevant for Indonesia if we try to recalculating the donations limitations. And in addition, the limitations on campaign fund donation based on minimum wage standard in each region relevant for Indonesia because the district of Indonesia based on the administrative area, so every area has a different limitations cap. This is the example. We try to recalculate the maximum donation based on the minimum wage in province of Java. We can cross with 12 times or 24 times to make more efficient for donations limitations. And the other things is the last thing is about the model of the fund expenditure. Our paper also recommended to adopt the maximum expenditure for legislative elections and also for presidential elections, not only for the local head elections. There are also four models to calculate the campaign fund expenditure based on fixed cost, based on number number of voters, like in UK. Maximum campaign spending limit are set £3,000 sterling per vote, and also our neighbor in Philippines, also they use this model, and the third model is minimum wage, and also there is the others model. Regarding with that, if we see the calculations of the campaign fund expenditure that regulated in local head elections, I think it's very high, because if based on our data collections in 20 and 20 elections from the provincial elections, if we see there is no one of candidate that closely enough with the total of limit of expenditure. So there is a gap between the amount of campaign fund expenditure that spent by the candidate with the campaign fund expenditure limit that formulated by the KPU. So we think that the formulation based on our regulations is very high, the gap between the total amount campaign and with the expenditure limit. Because of that, we recommend our papers to recalculating again the limit of campaign fund expenditure based on variable of minimum wage and also based on the number of voters in every elections. I think I will stop in here, Mas Anton, and I would love to make discussion if there is some questions from the other participants. Thank you.
Thank you, Mas Oi. Very interesting finding. Based on Mas Oi's research, there are three types of possible ways in calculating the limitation for donations. The first one is the fixed amount, like we use right now. And secondly, about the minimum wage, calculating based on minimum wage. And the other one is about the previous elections expenditure. And Mas Oi recommended that if we want to recalculate our donation limitation, we can also use the minimum wage as one of the way to calculate that, because he found out that there a gap between the actual expenditure that was reported to the KPU and also the ceilings for the maximum numbers of money that they can spend based on the KPU decisions. Thank you, Mas Oi. And now we move to our second speaker, Bang Fritz Ewa Ciregar. He is a member of the Badan Pengawas Pemilu or Election Oversight Body. He is also a lecturer at STH Indonesia Jentera, and in 1999 election, Bang Fritz was involved as a special staff at the Election Supervisory Commission Secretariat. And today you will be talking about observing campaign finance in Indonesian election. So we'll get lots of insight from what Bawaslu did during the elections related to the political or political party finance report. Bang Fritz, the time is yours. You have 15 minutes, Bang.
Thank you, Bung Anthony. Is my voice is loud and clear?
Yeah, it's good.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, and thank you for Perludem and Heroi, Mbak Titi, Mbak Lena, and Mbak Linis, and all the friends that are ready come and participate in our discussions. So I believe that we came here because we all agree that it's a campaign fund and also political finance is very critical during our democratic process. And as our role as the Bawaslu Election Supervisory Board, we observe one of our responsibility is to observe the campaign fund. And what I want to share is some of the challenges. So I think it's the challenges that that I think is our homework. So this is my presentation. So in my 15 minutes that I have, I try to speak three big part. The first part is regard the crucial issues for monitoring campaign fund. The second part is about the sanction related to campaign fund. And the part three is regard the legal framework or the loopholes that we found during the campaign fund rules. So I believe this is one of the opportunity for us to overcome and try to find the solution for the loopholes that we find during observing the 2019 campaign fund. Critical issue for the campaign fund. In Indonesia laws is very clearly stated that the campaign fund is not only money, but also money, object, and service. So we call it is money, goods, movable and immovable objects, and also service like performed by other parties. So all that three criteria is follow or under what they call it campaign fund. So maybe some person donate the money, but when someone is also doing the service, like the performance, the artist doing for doing the live, and this should be part of the what they call it campaign fund. So this is the first criteria that we have to agree that a campaign fund is always about the money. Sometimes maybe there's also people donate a t-shirt, sometimes they donate the food, sometimes they also donate the service of the car, and how they calculate it into their campaign fund. Like if there is one rental car provided rent for all the political parties, and when they put into the campaign fund, whether they consider as a campaign fund or they call it they fail to provide it and insert it into their campaign fund report. So what we do as the Bawaslu, again, as part of our responsibility to observe the election. So we are trying to check whether their compliance with the report, where their money coming from, and where the what the in is also the same with the out, where the money that is that get, then also the how they expense, and of course the authenticity and also the authenticity from the report, whether the report has a failure in the details, because the law is say that when you fail to submit the report, whether you are passing the deadline or you are miss details, it seems is considered that you are not provided your campaign fund report properly. And I think this is our challenge, because what if you are in your a campaign fund, there is a requirement that you have to put number of the identity number, or you forget to put your phone number, or there is no name of the there is no address. Maybe there is the name, there is the phone, but there is no address from the donor. Can we consider as the miss of the detail, or is a honest mistake, or this is a error, or is a fraud of from campaign fund report? During our experience, there is a time for I will coming back to that with that issue later, but there is the opportunity to amend or to make the revision of the campaign report, and this is one of the this challenging that what we have. So there is a in Indonesia there are four big part there's the four big part with regard a campaign fund. First about what we call it LRDK or initial campaign fund report, and the second part is LPSDK or report on receive and campaign fund donation, and also the last part is LPPDK report on the receive and expenditure of campaign fund, and also the last is the selection of the auditors. This is submitted through the system that already established by the election commission or the KPU, and that's where the political parties submit their report from the beginning of the campaign, in the middle of the campaign, and also in the end of the campaign. And of course there is a sanction, and there is during our experience we found there are several repeated activities. Like the first is donation in the same amount on the short interval, or they are very close. If you're looking to the bank report, is very short in the same number, in order to avoid the limitation that is already provided by the law. And also again the donation that are unclear or there is some mistake or there is some unfinished details from the donor, and also donation amount that are too small or too large. Sometimes the people asking why there is the too small is become of the problem, because we found in the practice there are some candidate, they become elected candidate, but their report is very small, and we wonder how this candidate with very small amount of the campaign report able to win the election. Yes, the formality has been accomplished, but how about the accountability with very small amount? There are some candidate that they are already zero in the very beginning of the campaign, and very small amount in the end of the campaign fund. And also we found the trend is the repeated donation from the same donor. There are the regulations. Of course, there is in the election law Article 525 regarding the exceeding the limitations, and also there is a false report. This is also what we when we call it the false report. What is the meaning of the false report? If I say that I have 1,000 millions, but in the report is 1,100 rupiah, is called it is false report, or is the false report is the 100 rupiah is considered as already subject to imprisonment and the fine, is also this is part of our difficulties when we are outsource the campaign fund. Of course, the shipping prohibited of the campaign fund, we have found this trend, but mostly in the local elections, not in the in the general elections. Of course, this is the exceeding reporting deadline. This is also one of our problem in the practice, because there are some parties that they submit their their report beyond the deadline that is already provided by the election commission. So my last part is about the loopholes in the campaign fund. There is some issues that we need to be addressed properly and settles. Is one is regard the again with the local elections, because there is no limitation that the money is coming from the candidate. So candidate can spend as much as their money that they want to give. And if, because we have the cooperation with the PPATK or the analytic of the transaction of in Indonesia, we get report that when someone become a candidate, more money come to their personal account, more money come to their account. So in Indonesia, the campaign fund should be put in one special account. But this is the account that need to be observed. But in reality, the money is go to their personal account, and most of the expenses is coming from their personal account and not their special account that is already established for this campaign fund. And also the campaign, one of the also the is our loophole is regard the deadline. Is the law is all this already provided that the deadline is 6 o'clock, like for example. But we found that there are several area that they are willing to accept the report beyond the 6 p.m. as the provided by election commission regulations, and also about the format, because the election commission regulations regard the campaign fund that you must use this specific report, but because there is a process, there is a time, there is a grace period that you can amend your report. So the political parties just give their report because they knew if there is something not correct, they have time to fix it again. So this is also the challenging to amend and also particularly with regard to the report for the campaign line. And of course, with regard to the auditor, we found that there are some auditor is working very, they are working in the several area. So when we select the auditor, it should be is we looking to the workload. What if there is one office able to oversee like 20 or 30 places, and it should be difficult to do. And also particularly when there is a possibility for the blacklist auditor also be part of to become the auditor. And the lastly, my slide is that until now, the Bawaslu or our election supervisor has no access to what the election commission system, what we call it CDACAM. This is the system that is already established by election commission for a campaign fund. So we don't know about the full report. So we only get the summary from the report. So if you want to know the detail of the all report, you must go to the system. But the system is handled and regulated and operated by the election commissions. And we as the election supervisory, we do not have the access. And I think is if we want to have the proper campaign fund observation, the election commission should be have the access to the application. So friends, so I think this is my presentations. So there is a challenges, there is the opportunity, whether is the challenges and the loopholes because of the law and regulations, but also there is a practice in the field like the most beyond the deadline or the details in the report, and that's what we need to, I think, is to correct for the future exercising. I think this is my presentation, Bung Anthony, and let's have for another discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bang Fritz. Thank you for your very thorough presentation and very comprehensive. You start with Bawaslu have already have criteria, what kind of suspicious transactions that need to be followed up by the Bawaslu. But unfortunately, there are also some loophole that make it quite difficult for Bawaslu, even though the Bawaslu already know there are several suspicious transactions, but in order to put the sanctions to the table, it's really difficult. And maybe that's something that we need to elaborate more during the discussion. Thank you so much. But before we move to our third speaker, I would like to remind participants that you can use the Q&A features. You can type your questions. You can use Bahasa Indonesia or you can use English. That's up to you, but we will have a translation out of that. So you can start raising, or you can also raise your hands, use the raise hand functions, so that when the Q&A sessions start, we already have several people that will ask questions. Now we move to our third speaker, Mbak Titi Anggreni. Welcome, Mbak Titi. Mbak Titi is a member of the advisory board of Perludem. Her involvement in Indonesian election has been spun for more than 2 decades. In 1999 election, she was member of the Elections Supervisory Committee, or Panwaslu. She was the executive director of Perludem up until mid-2020. And in 2017, she was appointed as the International Ideas Democracy Ambassador. And today, Mbak Titi will try to underline the topics of enhancing transparency and accountability of political party finance in Indonesia. And that will provide and also propose some solution of the problem that we discussed today. Mbak Titi, the screen is yours, Mbak Titi.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mas Anthony Lee, for introducing me. Friends, good afternoon. I hope you all safe and healthy amidst the COVID-19 pandemic situation. Referring to the previous speakers that more talk about the campaign finance, I will focusing my presentation on enhancing transparency and accountability of political party finance in Indonesia. To make my presentation more structured, I will share my short PPT. So, okay. In Indonesia, political party facing at least 2 dilemmas. First, political parties need a lot of money to finance their operation and election campaigns. And as you know, that election in Indonesia is very complex. When we mix between simultaneous election and the adoption of proportional open list system. So to win the seats, political party need to work not only to convince their candidates to work hard to reach the voters' votes, but also how to make sure that they can pass the parliamentary threshold 4% to be able to have a seat in a national parliament. And also the second dilemma, the large contribution makes the party not independent in fighting for the interest of the people. So in Indonesia, political party can accept 3 sources of funding. First, from the membership fees from the member of the political party, or in Bahasa Indonesia, what we call it as iuran anggota. And the second one is the donation from the third party. It could be from the individual or from the legal institution. And the last source for party finance is the state funding public funding. So the state allocates some amount of money for political party to be used as the funding to operate the political party. You can see that between the first dilemma and the second dilemma, when a party needs much money to finance their operation and election campaigns, but at the same time, when they receive large contribution, it can make the party not independent in doing their work to fight for the interest of the people. So how to solve this dilemma? At least we identified three steps to solve this dilemma. First, by encouraging political parties to be transparent and accountable, as what we discussed today. Second, to limit the amount of donation to political parties. And third, by providing financial assistance from the state budget, or what we call it as public funding schema. Let's discuss it one by one. Heroic already mentioned about the limitation on the donation to political party. So in Indonesia, we have two types of donation to political parties: donation during elections and donation outside the election stages. So public can donate to political party during the election. But also public can donate to political party outside the election stages. The first one, what we call it as campaign finance, and the second one, what we call it as party finance. So we have two different schema on the donation for political party. Donation for campaign finance, the numbers is so high, 7.5 billion rupiah for individuals maximum, and 25 billion rupiah for legal institution. Magnus Ohman and Marcin Walecki, researcher on party finance worldwide, mentioned that this limitation, one of the highest limit in the world, even from the amount, it's not willing to limit the amount because the amount is so big and tends not to limit the donation. So although we have the limitation, but it's not limit actually the donation because the limit is so high. And the state funding, public funding for political party is, as the third source of party finance, the amount now is 1,000 per valid votes for a national parliament and 1,200 rupiah per valid votes for the provincial parliament, and 1,500 rupiah for per valid valid votes for city and regency parliament. So you can imagine that this situation is not easy when we talk about transparency and accountability in Indonesian politics. And how about the when we talk about the transparency and accountability of political party finance, we still face so many barriers to party finance accountability. I noticed, or I listed several barriers that faced by us to have a party finance accountability. Money is increasingly dominant in Indonesian politics. The limit on donation for political parties is getting bigger from election to election, but accountability arrangements are still very minimal. As I mentioned earlier, that limit for campaign finance donation, 7.5 billion for individual and 25 billion rupiah for legal institution, that for the campaign finance donation. But we also have schema for party finance donation. Party finance donation, that donation received by party outside the election stages, maximum 5 million per maximum 1 billion per individual and 7.5 billion for legal institution. So it is still a big amount of money. And also, party finance is considered as a domestic domain of the party that does not require accountability in its use. It becomes a big barrier in promoting transparency and accountability in Indonesia because party finance is a domestic area. It's not a public area that can be reached by the transparency and accountability schema. Meanwhile, legal instruments are also unable to enforce financial transparency and accountability of political parties in Indonesia. There are differences in the accountability schema arrangements between campaign funds and political funds managed by parties outside the campaign period, regulated in two different laws, election law for campaign finance and political party law for party finance. And also the next barrier is the awareness of political parties and their actors towards the transparency and accountability of political funds is also very low. Ibu Lena maybe can add more information about this, but the transparency and accountability culture is not a lifestyle culture of our political parties. The transparency and accountability values not yet internalized as part of the values in the governance of political parties organization in Indonesia. Accountability of political funds has also become a consideration, has also not become a consideration for voters in determining their votes in election. So that's barriers that are faced by us in promoting the party finance accountability in Indonesia. And also the other barriers are the absence of political fund report supervisory agency. Pak Fritz talked much about in supervising the campaign finance, but we don't have mechanism to supervise the political fund report outside the election stages. Since we have two type of political finance, first campaign finance and second political party finance outside the election stages. But for the party finance outside the election stages, we don't have supervisory agency to supervise its accountability. And the currently the political party feels that there are no incentives and disincentives for transparency and accountability in the governance of political funds by them. Instead of using political finance accountability to create competitive election among political parties tends to ignore the issue of funding accountability in election. In fact, it is very tolerant of the issue of accountability for political funds. This is not an important or main, this is treated as not an important or mainstream issue for political parties. And so far, reporting on political funds has only been a formality to comply with existing regulation or as a conformity to the provisions in the law, has not reached the truth or accountability of the content of the report itself. And also the other barrier is the mechanism for administrative sanctions against reports on the misuse of state funds for political parties is not running optimally. So this is another dilemma, yeah? The public funding for political party, the amount is so small and not really significant in financing political party. But in another hand, the mechanism for administrative sanction against the misuse of the state funds is not running optimally. And the last one, the barrier we face in Indonesia, there is no schema to strengthen the quality of women's representation in the allocation of state funds to political parties. So although we have public funding for political parties, but the public funding not really contributed to strengthen women participation within political parties in Indonesia. Okay, I will finish them on the barriers to party finance accountability, and then I will jump to and how we enhance transparency and accountability in party finance in Indonesia. In my opinion, first, we need to increase the allocation of state funds to political parties so that there is strong legitimacy to demand transparency and accountability of political party funds. It is also apply in Germany and many countries in Western Europe who allocated significant funds from state to finance political parties. So it can balance the budget from the private sectors. Strengthening state funds for political parties is also an effort to avoid the domination of the influence of capital owners in controlling the party structure, as well as to open up more inclusive political access for potential party cadres with minimal funding. So we can provide even playing field for all potential cadres within a political party. And also because the accountability of funds is very influential on creating fair and equal election competition, it is necessary to have an institution that supervises the financial accountability of political parties. So not only supervising campaign finance, but also supervising the financial accountability of political parties. So all money managed by party can be treated accountable, can be supervised, so we can have access to its transparency and to its accountability. And the last one, I think in our current situation, meanwhile the law is not revised by the lawmakers, including election law, political party law, and also pilkada law. So civil society and the media must continue to educate the public about the importance of financial transparency and accountability of political parties and use them as a reference in casting votes in election. Even for the campaign finance report, although KPU as election commission, as mentioned by Pak Fritz, they have instrument called SIDAKAM, as information technology infrastructure to open or to publish the campaign finance report by the candidates to the public, but not many voters use the report as a reference to cast their votes in election. So I think more and more civic and voter education on this issue really need by us to make them more aware on this transparency and accountability of political party finance in Indonesia. I think I will stop there. I hope I don't limit my time. Thank you so much for the time. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you so much for your impressive presentation, Mbak Titi. You are still on time, so you even still have a few minutes left. But thank you so much. You have mentioned lots of barriers that we have to face in order to push forward the agenda of making political parties' finance report more transparent. For example, political party thinks that or consider that finance is a matter of domestic, political party domestic, so they don't want to talk about that openly. And the other is that they're also, the voters think that don't take into account the political finance transparency when they cast their votes in ballot box. And there's also several recommendations that Mbak Titi put forward for to be discussed. The first one is that to increase the state funding for political parties. And the other one is that civil societies and also media have to educate citizens so that they can take into account the political parties' accountability when they cast their vote in ballot box. Thank you so much, Mbak Titi. And now we have our last but not least fourth speaker, Mbak Lena Mariana Mukti. Welcome, Mbak Lena. She is a senior politician from Partai Persatuan Pembangunan. And Mbak Lena has been appointed by the Indonesian president and approved by the House of Representatives to be the Indonesian ambassador to the state of Kuwait. And beforehand, she is well known for her strong advocacy in the rights of women in politics. And she is also involved in Women Parliamentary Caucus. And today she will talk about political party finance affirmation for increasing women representation. Your Excellency, the time is yours.
Thank you, my brother, Anton. and my fellow speakers, Bang Fritz, Mas Heroik, and Titi, and also participant Southeast Asia. Thank you for giving me the very precious opportunity to share. I think I will talk based on my experiences, Mas Anton. But before I share my experiences, since I have been nominated 6 times since the new order to in election, so you could imagine that I have an experience from the new order and the reformation era. Actually, and very interesting to know what is happening in this country, especially when we reach this this situation. Especially that the political transaction politics in Indonesia become growing and bigger, Mas Anton. So, but first I would like to, before I would like to share that it's already there, my presentation, that in order to, because you asked me to talk about the women participation in politics, and especially on the affirmative action that we have been fight for decades. So I think it is good to open the eyes of the people that the importance to involve women in democratic process, because democracy without involvement of the women, the democracy will be deficit. That's as always I mention that democratic without involving women will be deficit. And of course that, but before, Mas Anton, allow me to switch off my camera, because I'm afraid that it will disturbing my presentation, if you don't mind. So in order to increase the number of women, the government should set an environment that helps promote women's interest in political parties. And of course that this shall bring a more democratic parliament where equality starts with the same opportunity for everyone, including women. Even though I said that the same opportunity for everyone, but we are still fighting for increasing the number of women in the parliament, at least 30% in the parliament. And also, the previous speakers stated that the biggest hurdle in this country, that the based on the 2009 survey, revealed that out of 300 institutions of the parliament institution around the world, that political finance is the biggest hurdle the female candidate to contest an election. And there is no such as regulation that to uncertain that women can participate in the political activities in this country by supporting like the gender budgeting, for example, Mas Anton. And of course the UN Women has held the research in 2013. The finding is that more than 80% of people interviewed admitted that the lack of access of finance to the finance is the biggest challenge for the female candidates to get into political arena. And I've been inspiring by what the United States, the NGO in the United States has established, the Women Funding women funding institution there and encourage women to run for the election, and they provide a sum of money and to ascertain that the women they choose as a champion in the parliament will be elected by the people. Even though the system in there in the United States is different with the political or election system in Indonesia, but I think that we can adopt what the women funding institution in the United States here, and they also have the Emily list, for example. Maybe you have heard that, Anton and others, and of course that. As Titi mentioned, that the role of money is in politics is indeed very crucial and means a lot to the success of the campaign. As we all know that the campaign has an influence on election results and will not work without the presence of a specific amount of money. And I would like to share the experience during the new order that supported by the people. For example, my party, the United Development Party, or PDP, at that time, we don't expend much money during campaigning because the people supported us by providing foods, meals, water, and also they make themselves the T-shirt with the logo of the party at that time. And I've been experiencing this very marvelous situation at that time. And now it's completely different. Now the other way around, that the candidates, the political party has provided them with the campaign tools and even meals and so, and I don't admit it. I admit that the candidates, you know, spends a lot of money during the, I think after the three previous elections. And what surprising me, the women also practices this. And the sum of the money during the legislative election also influenced by the local government election, because the local government election, they spend money, for example, one vote, 300,000 rupiah for one vote is to buy the vote. And this, you know, create the moral hazard in our politics, Mas Anton, because we cannot spend 50,000 per envelope, but we have to put 300,000. And I was surprised that one of the candidates that are women complained to me that she has spent about 4 billion rupees, and I was very surprised, and she lost still. I think that we have to think about that. What is happening? The people, the candidate who spend a lot of money, but still she cannot elect it. And I would like now to look at the affirmative action in providing funding for women. And women representation can be increased in three forms, including these incentives and incentives form. And this has been introduced by me, Mas Anton, during the debate of the election bill in 2007. Because if you know the term Simalakama, you know that, right? If you eat this Simalakama, your father will die. But if you don't eat this some kind of fruit, Simalakama, your mother will die. So because to put sanction in the bills is a very challenging for me at the time when I fight for the women female representation affirmative action in the bill. So we introduced the forms of disincentive and incentives instead. Instead of sanction, we introduce what we call the disincentives and incentive. So I think even though I prepared the three models of public fund affirmation for the women representation, I would like to we look at the model three public fund affirmation that state funds for political parties that are indeed allocated to improve gender equality and power and empower women's group in political parties. And PPP has introduced this during our last national congress in December 2020, that we put the regulation in our party's constitution that at least 30% of funding from the government, state funding from government, should be allocated for the empowering women politician in PPP. And I'm very thankful to my colleagues in PPP. They agreed to put this 30% ban poll or financial state for the party allocated for this. And if you look at the experience of Honduras and Ireland, before a political party gets an allocation of state funds, it is first required to report its expenditure of funds related to gender equality. And also practice in South Korea, for example, that they give the incentive for the not in the national level, but in the local level, they provide some of money as an incentive if they succeed to elect or to put women candidates in the parliament. And I think we can accommodate or replicate this regulation. And in Finland, state funds for political parties must be used to form the wings of women's organization of the political party. Most of the political parties in Indonesia has a women's wing, except I think PDIP used to be has the Sri Kandi women's wing, but no longer. And also PKS, a Prosperous and Justice Party, they don't have, but PKS is a very unique political party because the cadre of this party mostly that husband and wife, the pair of husband and wife, both of them are a cadre of the party. So I think it's not the big issues, no big deal for the PKS, even though they don't have the women's wings. And I would like to conclude my presentation by several recommendations that, as I mentioned earlier, that incentives in the form of increasing the allocation of state funds for parties that are able to increase women's representations. And this incentive in the form of reducing state funds for parties that do not allocate 30% for women's empowerment activities. As I said that it should be reduced funding from the state if they don't comply with this regulation. And of course that in-kind subsidy through the financing of advertisement in print or electronic media in campaigns. So this provision can also be specifically regulated for female legislative candidates For example, that 30% of the special time allocation slot in print and electronic media campaign advertisement for female candidates are financed by the SEC. I think Bang Fritz can also establish the memorandum of understanding with the KPI, the Indonesian KPI is Commission for Penyiaran Indonesia. So,
yeah.
And also with the media, yes, with the media also like Kompas and other media, they can put this. And so I would like to also close my presentation by offering solutions that we have to identifying and diagnosing the party finance problems, because from election to election, as you may aware, that the parties financing the biggest issue, and my colleagues in the parliament and the party, they seem reluctant to to make a regulation on the limitation of the expenditure during the campaign as proposed by Perludem, as mentioned by Herwig, and I supported this proposal on, you know, regulating the expenditure or limiting the expenditure of the party's campaign. And also we have to analyzing the existing legal frameworks governing political party finance. Titi has mentioned this many times in the previous presentation. And last but not least, we have to formulating policy recommendation for party finance reform, because the when we can arrange the political party comply with the regulation, I think that the democracy, the democratization in Indonesia will be on the right path. And also the KPK, Commission for Eradication of Corruption, even though they have looked at very closely with the party's finance and finding, but I don't see that the KPK has fulfilled what we expected by reducing the corruption, because the corruption still happens. And we cannot solve the problem if we cannot avoid the political transaction in this country. So that first we have to, overcome the funding or the finance of the political party first, before we talk about other things on ensuring that the democratization is in place in this country. Thank you for giving me the time, and I look forward to discussing what we have presented this afternoon. Thank you, Mas Anton.
Assalamualaikum.
Thank you so much. Assalamualaikum and good afternoon.
Thank you so much, Malena, for your comprehensive presentation. I think one of the most striking quotations that I got today from you is that democracy without involvement of women will be deficit. I think that's something that we have to bear in mind when we discuss this topic as well. And then Diana also forward some recommendations in order to give some affirmative action for women representation through the political finance in political party. And I'm very glad that P3, as Marina mentioned, has decided to allocate 30% of the set funding from the political party for women wing in the political party. And I think that is something that other political party also need to take into account when they want to improve women representation in politics. And but Lena asked to make some recommendations of giving incentive for those who unable to allocate 30% of the budget, political parties budget, or the set funding budget for women involvement in political parties, and give incentive for those who are able to do so. And there's also in kind of subsidy, for example, give the spotlight into women candidates in mass media. And also she gives some recommendations overall about how to improve the political party finance. Thank you so much, Balena. Now we have around 20 minutes for Q&A, and then another 10 minutes for all of the folk speakers to make some closing statement. And I see that there are already two questions here. Can the committee please help me to give the mics and also the video to Metrina Tosika? Perhaps you can all, you can deliver a question directly to the speaker. We'll open the chance for three questions. Metrina Tosika, please. Can you join us? Are you with us?
Hello?
Yeah. The time is yours. We can hear you.
Okay. Thank you for the opportunity. For the opportunity, I'd like to ask a question to this speaker about if we have a possibility to revise the recent law and the political party law. Can the company finance and finance reporting be integrated into the same information system? Because the remaining campaign funds owned by political party can be returned to the political party treasury. What about campaign finance payables and receivables? Because the report on the of the audit of campaign funds as the elections and the results of the audit of state finance as the year, I think it should be used by the public to monitor this, this as a precursor in the next election. Thank you.
Thank you, Metrina. And then another participant who already raised hand is, let me see, Mansur. Please, you can ask your question directly. You can ask your question in Indonesian language or in English. It's okay. Mansur, you raise your hand. While waiting for Mansur's question, I'll reread Metrina Tosika's question. If it's possible to revise the election law and the political party law, can the reporting of campaign finance and political party finances be integrated into the same information system? Because the remaining campaign fund owned by political parties may return to the treasury of political parties. Or what about the debts and receivables of campaign funds? The report on the result of the audit of campaign funds for each election and the result of the audit of state finances every year should be used by the public to monitor this as preference in legislation. So she highlighted the importance of having integrated information system for all of the campaign finance report and also for the political party finance report, where people can scrutinize the report and make some observations and also to monitor or even criticize the report. Mansur, do you want to ask your question? Okay, is there any participant who would like
May I answer what Metrina?
Okay, sure. Balena, the time is yours. We start with the first question first.
Mas Anton, yeah. Yeah, So I think what Matrina suggested us, I think it's the rights of the people, of the public, to know how the political party, you know, that, excuse me, I have to put up my camera off. I think that it is the right of the public. I always mention that to know, because to know the expenditure, the funding, state funding for the political party, because it comes from the people, and the people has to be given the right to look at, you know, easily through the media, for example, in the website of the parties, that they have to report to the people, to the public, every 1 year, the spending of the money. If they cannot, give a report to the public for the next year funding, it should be reduced. It's a kind of incentive that can be given to the party, so they know. But I would like to also respond to what he said, that if I'm not mistaken, that Titi said that the fund, or the sum of the money, the funding of the...
Marina, we cannot hear you clearly.
State to the political parties will be increased. And, you know, that I'm still doubt on this proposal, Titi, because what the main problem in the party, you can start from the how they are the guillotine, that the what is the competency is not important. How about now? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
How about
now? Hear you clearly, Mamba.
Hello.
No, we can hear you clearly.
Hello.
We can hear you clearly,
Mamba. Hello. Mas Anton, yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello, Mas Anton.
It's really clear now.
Can you hear me? Hello.
Hello? Yes, we can, yes, hear, we can you. Hear you.
I'm sorry that there seems there is a problem. Oh my God. So, yeah. So I think that if we talk about the party, yes, if you talk about the party financing, okay. Okay, so if we talk about the party financing or state funding for the political party, we have also to look at how they, conduct the party leadership election there, because there is an adagium that you know, Mas Anton, my fellow speakers, that. What is it, Titi? Is it us? Is more important. So money is more important
than competency and capacity.
Competence. The adagium is, that we know that. Is it us lebih penting dari apa, Titi? Kok tiba-tiba lupa. So I forgot the term. That
money in your pocket in is bahasa, more important, yes, than your capacity.
Is it more than more important than
your quality
capacitas? right? Yeah. So kapasitas or capacity is not, yes, kualitas, quality. So money more important than competence, capacity and competence. So I think that we know exactly this adagium in this country that we have to fight for. That I believe that if you start reducing the practice of buying food during the party leadership election, and from there you can reduce the buying food or the campaign that's a very high cost, right? And I would like to ask Perludem to look at this and make a research on how the political party elect their leader. Thank you, Mas Anton.
Thank you, Mbak Lena. Bang Fritz, maybe you can jump and also provide your perspective on the question that was given by Matrina.
Thank you, Mbak. I think it's what we dream for. What is we dream for? That is the connection. There is like one of our recommendations years ago to, and still now to the election commissions. How, what if we impose like the, there is no case basis for the transaction for all the campaign fund. All the transaction is should be in digital. You can see the all the transactions. This is only the entry point before we can establish the whole coordination between the political parties fund and the campaign fund, the candidate fund, because we're talking about the three, like what Heroic already say, there is different regulations about the political parties laws, regulations about also the general election laws, and also local election laws. And that three laws is combined with political parties and campaigns, and also could combine with the campaign fund. And I think we have still long, it's very long reach to have that kind of the idealistic. But maybe we can start first step, like impose all the expenses through the online, and also to there is no case basis. This is the first one. And also there is the second one, there's all people, including the supervisory and also public, able access not only to report, but also to the access where that money coming from and to spend for what? Like, okay, to buy food, to buy banner, to buy t-shirt, that's okay, but or to pay advertisings. That two level of transparency is, I think, is will provide huge advantages and also transparency for political parties, the candidate, and also for us to see the quality of the better democracy. That's my questions, Bung Antoni.
Thank you, Bang Fritz. Mbak Titi?
Yeah, I strongly agree with Pak Fritz about the idea to connect between the political party finance report and also with campaign finance report. Since long time ago, we are in Perludem proposing an idea to have like a special law to regulate party finance, that in that law including campaign finance. So all the finance managed by political parties, including campaign finance, regulated in one special law called party finance law or undang-undang keuangan partai politik. So by having that law, we can make a connection between the reporting of campaign finance and the party finance as whole in as a as well in a political party. So to respond to your question, Mbak Metrina, we are in Perluden not only proposing the connection between the report of party finance and campaign finance, but also to have a special law to regulate party finance that including all the money in political parties. That's the first response. And the second one about the technology. I think it is very important to use the technology as a transparency and accountability instruments. Since by using technology, it can like encourage public to create more creative participation in supervising the accountability of politics. As we can learn from 2014 election, once KPU decided to open all the curriculum vitae of the candidates in machine readable format or CSP, even in 2014, it not yet CSP, still JPEG and PDF, it push us in Perludem to together with the IT geeks and IT developers to create platforms that can facilitating public tracing their candidates' track records by reading their curriculum vitae. And I'm sure if we have this kind of IT platform for party finance report, public can come with their creativity to taking part in supervising the accountability of party finance and campaign finance report. I think we need to voice it this again and again, since currently our lawmakers decided not to revise the election law and the political party law and also pilkada law. So our hope election commission or KPU can come up with innovation and terobosan itu innovation ya. Innovation and creativity to increase the level of transparency of campaign finance report, as mentioned earlier by Pak Fritz, not only publishing the donation and spending, but also the detail spending and the detail use of the campaign finance received by the political party. If we see from the last election report, the report is not only really a report, only public accountant office can access the detail of the report, but public, we can only access the general report that based on the general ledger, but not in the detail, the allocation of the money that received by the political party. So the type of the report publication itself not only helping public to understand about the accountability of the campaign finance report that conducted by the political party. I think we work together to consistently promoting and pushing that issue. We hope that for the future we can have a special law on the political party finance law in Indonesia. Thank you, Mas Anton.
Thank you so much, Bu Atiti. Mas Oik, perhaps you can also give your two cents on this issue.
Okay, thank you, Mas Antoni. Actually, there are a lot of answers that respond by Batiti, Pak Fritz, and also Bulena regarding the questions. But I would like add more a little bit. If we see, because there is some different approach between these three law, local head elections, and then legislative and presidential elections, and also about the political parties laws itself. These three laws have a different approach to regulate the political party finance. And they approach is also different. For example, when campaign finance is based on the election law, it must be submitted and reported to the Indonesia Elections Commission. And after that, the Indonesia Elections Commission or the KPU will be sending it to the private auditors. Then private auditors will be audit the campaign finance report that submitted by the political party participants. But it's different when we talk about the political party finance law. The audit mechanism is responsible by the state auditors. Because political party receive the public donations or state budgets in three different levels. So every last year, every in the end of the years, every political party must be audited by the state budget state auditors. So when I think it's a good idea when we try to make this political party finance system report in which will be integrated with one codification clause, like Mbak Titi mentions, Perudem also proposed and recommended to make special laws about the political party finance issues. It is about the campaign finance and also political party finance regulated in just only in one law. Because as we see, because there is the difference electoral laws, for example, what it makes different in local head election, there is some expenditure limit. But why in presidential elections and also in legislative elections, there is no expenditure limitations? What it makes difference? So when we try to combine these three laws become one codifications law or one political party finance law, it will be make some equal treatment approach for political party regarding the political party finance issue, also about the campaign finance issue. And my second answer related with the role of technology, I think it is important because there is so many countries that using the role of technology to make political party more transparent and accountable, and also to make more people engage and participate to oversight the political party finance issue. Technology is the tools that make political party more transparent. For example, if we know in the United States of America, there is a super PAC. They all publish the report of campaign finance and also political party finance outside the elections in every each detail. But now when we talk about Indonesia context, even though the KPU have SIDAKAM or campaign finance system informations, but when we try to more to look more deeply, we should see the document that submitted by the political party participant. The SIDAKAM just only make some overview or resumes from the numbers, total numbers of campaign expenditure and also donations for the political party. But when we try to look more deeply, where is the money come from and for what kind expenditure that political party spend the money during the campaign or outside the elections, sometimes it's difficult to ask to ask to public and to civil society organization like Perudem to investigate more deeply where is the source of the money come from. So I think the role of technology is important to make political party more transparent, and also I think it's also helpful for the KPU also and the Bawaslu to make to ensure the political parties meet the all regulations that regulated in elections law or in political party for political party law. I think that's all, Mas Anton.
Thank you so much, Mas Ori. We have less than 10 minutes before we end our discussion. I'll give each of the speakers around 2 minutes to give some closing statement. But beforehand, I would like also to pose questions that maybe all the speakers can answer that during the closing statement, because it seems that we already know the cure of the disease of the political finance problem in our country. But the problem is that how to force the legislative, who is in charge of revising our regulations, to adopt those good measures to make sure that the political finance campaign reform will be done in our country. While this very regulation will limit their movement in elections. And if we have more politicians like Balena, this is might not be the problem. But I think out of 575 legislators in the House of Representatives, not all have the same opinion as Balena. Perhaps this this question can also be answered by the speaker during the closing statements. I give the floor to Batiti first.
Thank you, Mas Anton. Towards to 2024 elections, that will be a very complex and heavy burden election for election organizers, election contestants, and also voters. I think we cannot put this issue about transparency and accountability on political party finance, specifically on campaign finance, away. Yeah. I'm so worried that because of the complexity and then our concentration more on how to fix the complexity and then we avoid the idea to supervise the transparency and the accountability of a campaign finance report in 2024 election. So myself personally, I'm expecting that civil society together with media to have like synergy and collaboration to keep promoting transparent and accountable party and campaign finance in Indonesia, and also to push and also to encourage election organizers, including election supervisory body, to give their more focus to make sure the truth and accountable campaign finance report in 2024 election, because I believe that there's no free and fair election if there is no transparent and accountable campaign finance governance in our elections. Thank you, Mas Anton. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Mbak Titi. Mbak Lena, perhaps you can also give your closing statement.
Yeah, it will be very short, Mas Anton, and I will support what Titi said, that the Commission of Elections should have an innovative regulation, and I think we have the jurisprudence on this when the PKPU number 7/2013 on ensuring that the political party put comply with the affirmative action policy. And I think they can also make this innovation on the state funding or the the report of the funding, especially during campaign, because I have to say that it quite difficult in the parliament now, especially there is no plan to revise the election laws, and we don't know if what they promised, that it will be limited revision of the election laws and also to revise the political party. But until now, we don't hear the plan to revise these two laws. So I think since the election commission will be, will be ended their duty on next year, 2020, and this October, I believe that the president will appoint the selection committee. So we have to start from this, Mas Anton, that the KPU, the Commissioner in Election Commission, and also a member of Bawaslu, should be the people that fulfill our needs we can trust them. So in short, that we can trust them. So if we have a very good commissioner and with that the innovation of the regulation from KPU and also Bawaslu will be there. Thank you, Mas Anton. Assalamualaikum.
Thank you so very much, Mbak Lena. Thank you so very much. And Bang Fritz, you can also give your closing statement.
Yeah. Thank you, Bung Antoni. It's very difficult question to answer, to be honest. And at least from our point of view, I think we can start what we have. I think as the Bawaslu, we also our reflection that we like as suggestion by Mbak Titi that we must use our authority more firmly and as accordance by the law is more strict. And also there's the cooperation with the KPU because we believe, I think there is a very essential issues why we talk about this campaign fund and also political party finance. There is the bigger issue that we need to address and reporting campaign fund and it is one of the important issues and I think is if the political party believe that they want to become more democratic and transparent political parties, they could be a stronger political parties. But I think is the decision is not is on us but to the political parties leaders. But as us as the election sorry board, we are thank you for the support and thank you that and also thank you from Mbak Lena and also Mbak Titi and Mas Heroic that for the future reference that we more regulated and more using the technology to observe the campaign materials because we can start from the campaign materials and the compliance with the campaign report and we can synchronize it and whether this is a proper campaign report or not. And that's what we are doing right now. Thanks, Bung Antoni, and thanks everyone for the great discussion.
Thank you so much, Bang Fritz. And last but not least, Mas Oib.
Yeah, thank you, Mas Anton. First, on previous conference with the international idea, one of the issue is the overregulated is not good to regulate the political party. I mean, like, when we try to regulate the political party finance issue, it must be proportional. Because if there are too overregulated, I mean, like it will more political parties movement more limited. For example, in campaign finance, if we limit to low for political party donations, it also difficult for political parties and candidate to run their campaign. But I think one of the important things when we talk about the political party finance reform, especially to revise the elections laws or political party finance law, we should make clear objective. What aspect that we will revise? Because based on our experience, every elections law revisions, every political party laws revisions, there is no clear objective to make political party more transparent. For example, the revision always discuss about the increasing of the limitations of the donations. There is no the limitations for expenditure, and also there is no regulations for the limitation donation from the candidate and also political party. So political party and candidate can spend their own money as much as they have. So I think it's important to ask to make more clear objective when we try to revise the elections law and political party law, for example, to make more transparent. It is my second opinion. And the third opinions, when we talked about political party finance reform, it not also come from the political party itself. I think it also from the more participatory process, it is important. Because if I'm not mistaken, when Perludem civil society organization and other civil society organization, also LIPI, purpose to increasing the public funding to political party. If I'm not mistaken, there is some survey from the poster or the media, if I'm not mistaken, the public is reject to the increasing the public funding. I think because this is the lack of information. I think this is because there is no public forum for political party to explain and also to us to explain about the important thing about the public funding to make political party more transparent and also accountable. So what the other things is important is political party finance, if not impact to the political party itself. So there is the relations between the political party finance about the quality of democracy, about the political corruptions, and also about the participatory and the representative of public in the political party. Because political party has significant roles in democracy. So the quality of democracy based on the quality also about the political party. So I think that's all, Mas Anthony. Of course, I would like to say thank you to Mbak Titi and also Pak Fritz and Bu Lena for making this happen. And I think we have a lot of homework to do some political party finance reform in the future. Thank you, everyone. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat sore.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Mas Oi. Now we are nearing the end of the discussion. I'm not going to sum all of the speakers' point of view because they already summed that and also give a closing statement. Now I will give the chance to Mbak Theresia Joyce to give her closing remarks. She is the respective chief of party. But Joyce, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Anthony. Honorable speakers, Bapak Fritz Edward Siregar, Kak Lena Mariana Mukti, Mbak Titi, Heroik Mutakin Pratama, USA representative, friends and colleagues. Thank you for taking part in this webinar. I think this is important as part of our support to the credibility of political party financing system in Indonesia. On behalf of Respect Program, I also would thank you, the host of this conference, Perludem, to invite and to give me opportunity disclosing remarks. And I will use this opportunity to conclude and resound message that to nourish the democratic process in Indonesia, one of the urgent steps that must be taken is to reform the financing of political parties. It is a foundation to move forward a prosperous and established democracy. But I also understand that political party financing reform is not easy to do. Even Perludem has taken a title for its research, Political Party Finance in Indonesia, a Never-Ending Reform. In this context, we need to work together. Public, civil society organizations, journalists, actors can play a critical role in strengthening political party finance system. They can be allies in garnering support for legislative change, to advocate to the adoption of significant standards for the setting up of transparent system for political party financing. With same purpose, political parties also need to listen to public and their voters, provide affirmative financing for women and other marginalized groups, as well as responsible and accountable on the resource they manage. This event is a milestone, part of significant stages of a process have been gone through by Perludem and for other organizations in Southeast Asia region to support the independence and integrity of elections and political processes. The other organizations are Bersih 2.0 from Malaysia, Lente from Philippines, Pradet and Women Caucus from Timor Leste. As Ninis mentioned in the opening remarks, that this webinar also is held to commemorate the International Day of Democracy, which for this year has taken topic on strengthening democratic resilience in the face of future crisis. I hope through this event today and series of advocacy activities that will be carried out in the next coming months, we can contribute to support to create a healthy democracy, to uphold the rule of law, protect and respect basic principles of accountability and transparency and integrity. Thank you for your attention and your participation, and I wish you all a great evening. Anthony, I give back.
Thank you, Mbak Joyce. Dear participant, we are already finished our discussion, but the committee asked me to remind you that there will be a feedback survey that the committee hope that you can fill in that after you leave the Zoom meeting. You receive that on your Zoom feedback. Please do so. I thank you so very much for the speakers and the participant to participate actively in this webinar, and hopefully that we are all will be healthy and our discussion will be fruitful, and there will be some changes in the political party finance regulation. I thank you so very much, and goodbye.
Thank you.
Goodbye. Thank you.
I will leave now. Bye.